Have you ever watched a movie and one character just doesn't look right? Maybe you've seen a robot that was created to act as human-like as possible, but it just creeped you out. Well, you're not alone, and this occurrence is actually quite common. Popularly known as the Uncanny Valley, this idea has only recently become a common topic, as progress in robotics and computer animation have allowed for on-screen and in-person creations that are quite close to replicating real life. So today we're going to take a look at various explanations of what causes the Uncanny Valley, if it even exists, and of course cover some bad missteps and downright creepy instances of the phenomena. The word uncanny is defined as seeming to have a supernatural character or origin, eerie or mysterious. Sigmund Freud wrote a book called The Uncanny in 1919, in which he studied the experience of something not only mysterious, but strangely familiar. The word was first used in our context by Masahiro Mori, a professor at the Tokyo Institute of Technology. In 1970, he published his titular essay, The Uncanny Valley, in the Japanese journal Energy. Mori wrote, "I have noticed that, in climbing toward the goal of making robotics appear human, our affinity for them increases until we come to a valley, which I will call the Uncanny Valley." To illustrate his thesis, he published a corresponding graph. The x-axis follows the human likeness of an object, from a basic robot to a healthy person. The y-axis corresponds to the affinity that a regular person feels towards the object. This includes both the person's comfort level, as well as their ability to establish some sort of relationship with the object. Beginning on the left, Mori uses an industrial robot as a baseline. It serves as an object that does not resemble a human, but also does not bother us, because we can recognize exactly what it is. Continuing along the curve, a toy robot might bear a closer resemblance to a human, thus Mori postulates that it is easier to establish an emotional connection. This curve keeps moving upwards and to the right, the closer we get to a healthy human. But at some point, as objects get closer and closer to human-like, this level of comfort drops off steeply. Then, at some other stage, the relationship begins to increase yet again, forming the walls of the Uncanny Valley. Finally, Mori suggests, the curve peaks when we reach a healthy human, at which point a full emotional connection can be formed and comfort levels are highest. This valley on the graph depicts the low point in our emotional response, the uneasy feeling upon encountering an entity that blurs the line between a human and something unknown. At some point, some objects appear so close to being a human that we can almost trust them. But one small quirk about how they look, move, or act can create the pit of unease in our stomach. And it isn't just humans that react in such a manner. Monkeys also react adversely to images of their species that have been modified. But the graph is just a heuristic, a simple way of conveying a complex message. We are trying to answer the question, what causes that uneasy underlying feeling? While many have put forth explanations as to why we get this feeling, no one really knows for sure. The violation of expectation hypothesis suggests that when we see something human-like, we expect it to act and look a certain way. But when the object does not conform to our expectations, we become uneasy. Many theories assert that the feeling we get is an evolutionary response to danger. After all, for most of human history, humans have had to use their instincts as their first line of defense. A popular theory in this category is the pathogen avoidance hypothesis. This idea suggests that we developed this feeling as an evolutionary alarm bell, subconsciously warning us of danger posed by sick or infected humans. When ill, typical human traits might distort in response to the sickness. For example, pale skin, a rash, or labored breathing. Because a sick human poses a greater risk to humans than other animals, naturally we try to avoid these people. Another theory, the mortality salience hypothesis, takes an even darker approach. In this line of thought, the inconsistencies that we see in human-like objects are so off-putting because they literally remind humans of death. This could stem from a lack of a palpable soul in many animations or robots, especially in the eyes. If we dig a little deeper, we may be able to flush out some of the overall ideas that form the basis for nearly all of these theories. Most who have researched this subject can agree that the core reason for the feeling of uneasiness is a sense of danger. Carl McDormand, a professor at Indiana University, posits that we sense a threat from a perceived mismatch. Perhaps the skin was the right color, but the eyes were too big, or they acted normal, but they would laugh at inappropriate times. Of course, this mismatch only comes when the object is supposed to be human. This is why many cartoons do not upset its viewers. We can understand that it's meant to be a representation of a human. In a similar vein, this is why something like a shark in the water doesn't cause this uneasy feeling. In that moment, we can pinpoint the threat without any second thoughts, which induces fear rather than some vague uncertainty. The term the Uncanny Valley is only a few decades old and has only been in the public eye since the early 2000s. Advances in technology, robots, and especially CGI are truly pushing the boundary between the fictional and real world. Before the 21st century, most technology simply hadn't gotten to the point where animated movie characters or robots looked lifelike. Movies relied on makeup and physical models, while advanced robots only resembled humans in shape. However, with movies like The Lord of the Rings paving the way for motion capture and CGI, the door was opened for creators to design objects as realistic as possible. Advances in material science and software have enabled for the creation of robots who can not only talk, but have skin and blinking eyes. But for all of the possibilities that creators have, they must proceed with caution. The first major case of the Uncanny Valley in popular culture was 2004's The Polar Express. Although helmed by Tom Hanks, the lifeless animation agitated both children and adults. As with many cases of the Uncanny Valley, the soulless eyes create a situation in which no matter how lifelike the object is, people struggle to connect emotionally. Robots also fall into a similar trap. Even as they have become significantly more humanoid, the improvements almost work against this feeling of realism. Sophia, for example, is capable of displaying a range of emotions and expressions, yet the way it moves its head or stares blankly into the distance is extremely unnerving. In even worse cases, robots like Telenoid have features that resemble a human, but the bald head, stumpy limbs, and horrific eyes make it seem almost alien. Many argue that although robots may seem eerie and possibly capable of harm, once you experience them in person, this feeling fades quickly. While holding a conversation with a robot like Sophia can be off-putting, when you see the limits of what it's capable of, such as struggling to do something as simple as walk, the feeling of danger subsides. This is an important point. In person, the uncanny feeling vanishes. When we think about everything that we've gone over so far, this makes sense. Robots may seem strange at first, but once you experience them firsthand, the uncanny disappears. From here, we can conclude that the uncanny feeling is mostly experienced remotely. If we see something on screen that creeps us out, we never have the chance to reconcile these feelings like we might with a robot. Sadly, no one is ever going to be able to converse with the conductor of the Polar Express or sing and dance with human-cat hybrids. The experience we have with characters on screen is entirely one way, and ultimately emphasizes the importance for filmmakers to get character design correct immediately. Some filmmakers fail to realize this, and inevitably drag down the overall success of the film. 2020's Sonic the Hedgehog was delayed for 3 months after a public outcry about the hedgehog's design. A 1988 short film, called The Tin Toy, was panned for having what some called the most disturbing piece of animation in history. However, successful filmmakers utilize the idea of the Uncanny Valley to their advantage. On one hand, horror movies exaggerate human features to compound on any feeling of dread. While a big alien might be scary, this scene from The Conjuring is truly horrifying.
Let her go! God damn it! Let her go!
She's already gone. And now you're all gonna die. Bathsheba!
Not only are the facial expressions gruesomely contorted, but the deep voice and laughter certainly extinguish any feeling of hope. On the other hand, there are teams that understand the exact opposite of the Uncanny Valley. Known as baby schema, if you exaggerate the right parts of a creature's body, it can be found even more attractive to the viewer. Baby Yoda became a sensation, and for good reason. The small mouth, big eyes, and large ears took thousands of hours to perfect, and in the end, motivate the viewer to care more about him. The Uncanny Valley is a difficult subject to quantify in data, which in turn means it is hard to prove scientifically. But the fact that an uneasy feeling comes over many when viewing poor animation or watching a robot attempt to speak is undeniable. If you haven't truly felt uneasy yet, this image should do the trick. This sculpture, titled Mother Bird, serves as a great example of how the almost human look can take a turn for the worst. Perhaps it reminds of a sick person, like a leper. Or, returning to the mortality salience hypothesis, perhaps such an uncomfortable figure really does remind us of death. Either way, where Momo falls on Mori's proposed curve, or even if the curve exists, is up for debate. Several years after initially publishing his essay, Mori would go on to revise his theory. The right side of the valley was not peaked by a healthy human, but in fact extended beyond, towards the ideal human. Mori's general example for this is the impeccable face on a Buddhist sculpture. Some, like Christoph Bartnek at the University of Canterbury in New Zealand, think there is no valley, just a cliff. He has been unable to find anything on the upward section of the valley's curve. However, this may not always be the case. While today, robots like those seen in Terminator or Blade Runner don't exist, with the way technology is advancing, it is only a matter of time. Perhaps then, the border between machine and human will be fully blurred. If you guys are interested in any further reading about the Uncanny Valley, I've put my sources in the description. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and if you did, please remember to like and subscribe. Thanks, and I'll see you guys in the next one.